А и следующий доклад Екатерина Деготь. Концептуальные практики в Москве, объекты перформансы, инсталляции, рассказы. Думаю, что не надо особенно представлять Екатерину Деготь нашей аудитории. Замечательный критик, куратор и шеф художественной части портала Open Space.
Рада видеть множество друзей всех вместе. Я очень благодарна за приглашение на этот симпозиум и за то, что он вообще в принципе проходит. Я хочу специально сказать для своих юных друзей и своих студентов, которые здесь присутствуют, что подобного рода мероприятия... Секунду, мне очень трудно... Игорь, я умоляю, мне очень трудно разговаривать. Подобного рода мероприятие не могло бы состояться 10 и даже 5 лет назад, я имею в виду, когда о московском концептуализме говорили бы зарубежные специалисты, в том числе наравне с русскими, хотя они уже существовали, но еще не было достаточно почвы, не состоялось достаточно выставок, не было издано достаточно книг. Достаточно информации не циркулировала в мировом контексте, чтобы такое событие могло состояться. Так что, хотя, возможно, моим студентам все это кажется совершенно естественным, на самом деле это большой прорыв, то, при чем мы здесь сегодня присутствуем. Я также должна извиниться перед русскоязычной аудиторией, что я буду так же, как и все русские участники, говорить по-английски. Причины этого понятны. Я хочу облегчить жизнь нашим переводчикам, потому что, конечно, мой плохой английский язык перевести на русский будет значительно проще, чем мой, надеюсь, более богатый русский язык на английский. So I'm switching to English. So my text... Я надеюсь, мы на этом закончим, да? Больше фотографий не будет, да, во время речи, да? Очень прошу. My text was originally called "Performing Objects, Narrating Installations." I must say that I actually decided to skip narrating installations part because it would take too long to narrate installations. It's for the next time, but I'll tell you where I wanted to insert this part somehow. Another thing I wanted to say before I begin, it's an concerns performing objects part, and now a small advertisement pops up. There is a small exhibition which is called Performing Archive, and which we did with David Reif and with our students at Moscow School of Photography and New Media, Alexander Rachenko School, in EK Art Bureau. So this is an experimental exhibition of very young artists, our students, who were somehow referring to both of the topics that important for Moscow, conceptualism, performance, and archive. And writing this text, I was, and preparing this small exhibition, I was keeping the same thoughts in mind. So performing objects, narrating installations. It seems to me during this conference that we're somehow stuck with Moscow romantic conceptualism. And if we are, I would give my and very simple interpretation of what romantic actually means. Romantic simply means not classical. So Moscow conceptualism is not classical, or as some people would formulate, not classical enough. We still have to discuss, is Moscow conceptualism an original phenomenon and where its originality can be found, or is it a belated and weaker version? To many an outsider, Moscow conceptualism seems to be not cool enough, not cold enough, not analytical, not immaterial enough to qualify as conceptual art in the first place. And here to illustrate it, I'm showing one of the Dmitry Prigov's early work, which could hardly qualify as a conceptual artwork. I don't see anything, huh? I won't. Okay, so, I don't know. Оставить свет в зале или выключить? Оставить, да? Okay, so then, no, okay, well, there will be light in the room, the quality will be worse, but it's okay. For those who haven't seen it, so it's a huge work and very strong, I believe. My answer to the question of originality of Moscow conceptualism would be that we have to take into account that this art was rooted in an extremely original economic system, which made many of the axioms of Western conceptual art and even avant-garde invalid. How can we speak of a vector of blurring boundaries between art and life, so typical up until today, I would say, for international avant-garde and contemporary art, when art and life were already blurred in the most radical way? And looking closely, we might find some of these conditions in a different form, but nevertheless, around us today. International artistic practices of the neo-avant-garde of the 60s and early 70s often include what has been described as a rediscovery of the figure of artist. The most experimental art zone included happenings, performances, and body-related practices. I can mention here, of course, Yves Klein, Le Saut dans le Vide, as well as his other projects, Alan Kaprow, Vito Acconci, Gutai practices, Lydia Clark, and of course, Marina Abramović with Ulay. This expression of the subjective freedom, to the extent it was legally possible to be expressed, was something one could expect from an artist in an already post-Stalinist Soviet Union of the 60s and 70s, since totalitarianism is usually described as a suppression of subjectivity. Indeed, we find some of these works existing, like this performance by Rima and Valery Gerlovens, but they represent a relatively rare case. They are not even included in the normative body of work of Moscow conceptualism by Moscow conceptualists themselves, and are intuitively perceived as something Eastern European. So this looks like Eastern European conceptualism rather than Moscow conceptualism. Contrary to all expectations, which isn't making it worse, of course, it's quite an interesting page of Moscow conceptualism, I believe, which is still not explored enough. Contrary to all expectations, the experimental and risky zone inside artistic practices of Moscow conceptualism was rather linked to art making as such, to display of art, which took form of a performance of a kind. So artwork was a more risky zone than figure of an artist. I do not even mean institutional initiatives which artists took, including first illegal outdoor exhibitions where artists were holding works in their hands. Also, this is also important. What Soviet neo-avant-garde artists were experiencing at that time in the 70s was rather a rediscovery of an art object, and even, to be more precise, a quest for it. So this is one of the performances of the NEST, Gniezdo group, of the series Non-Functional Art, 77, and it's called An Attempt to See Oneself in the Past and Future. Here, young artists are jumping and turning around, hoping to see themselves during this turn in a previous moment in the past, like on a photograph, or in the next moment of future, like in a flash of intuition. But in any case, as a fixed image, and this seems to be a utopian eternal quest with no result. To objectify oneself in this sense is close to a heroic deed, since this has to be a breakthrough from living your art, experiencing it performatively, to at least envision it as a static image, as an autonomous object. And obviously, a documentary photograph of this event as such did not fulfill this task for the artists. In now famous Monastirsky's Finger, the very possibility of an autonomous aesthetic object for contemplation is quite physically touched upon. This ironical device examines the possibility of pointing at the subject as if it were an external object. By putting his or her finger into the box and pointing at him or herself, a person realizes an operation of self-objectification, an operation that signals alienation and simultaneously a painful but so desirable separation of the art product from its creator entangled in communal relationship. So Monastirsky is very carefully testing the ground of alienation as a condition of existence of art as such. It is usually said that the practices of Moscow conceptualism are immaterial, that they didn't need, the artists didn't need to produce any work since they were constantly communicating and telling each other their plans anyway. This is to some extent true, and we will certainly hear something interesting on the subject from Anton Vidokli this afternoon. But if we look closer, we nevertheless will see that they were producing sometimes even more than it was required, and in an obsessive way. Let's take the activity of collective actions, which doubled and tripled every real experience with descriptions and comments bounded in volumes. And many of the actions were surrounded by objects, or in Prigov's case, obsessive production of books. It is true that the figure of an artist is one of the most important topics of Moscow conceptualism. It is also true that it is immediately turned into an object, a character in the narrative. And Comrade Melad made projects about fictitious historical artists, Apelles Diablov and Nikolai Butyumov. In Dmitry Prigov's early dramas, which precede his installations, and we can read his future installations in his very early and partly unpublished text of early 70s. Even earlier than Kabakov's installation, of course. Then in Ilya Kabakov's famous 10 characters and other installation, the whole team of artists as characters, so typical of Moscow conceptualism, is about producing alienation. Of course, these narratives were quite realistic since Moscow conceptualism lived in a country where everybody was or was considered an artist. I would even say everybody and everything, including artworks. The discovery of subjectivity in the West or in Yugoslavia took place amidst abundance of objects in society, be it artworks or consumer goods. To organize an empty show in an art gallery or a happening there, one had to have expectations to see there something in the first place. But in Soviet Union, rare everyday objects existed amidst overabundance of non-reified subjectivities of very different kind. In his insightful book about New York conceptual group around art dealer and curator Seth Ziegelaub, Alexandra Albera finds roots of these practices in the new economical paradigm of early informational capitalism, providing services, manipulating information. He interprets conceptual art as an overlap of business and art and sees the alleged dematerialization of object not as a disappearance of commodity status, but as a fusion with advertisement. If we look at Moscow conceptualism from this point of view, considering dominant modes of production and art production under which conditions it works, we will see a completely different picture, which would explain why it is not dematerialized enough. The dematerialization of an artwork and fusion of art with advertisement or propaganda, in this case, took place in Soviet Union much earlier as a result of successful anti-capitalist revolution of late 20s, early 30s, although in a completely different forms, which might first seem mimetic, and realistic. One of the ultimate ambitions of communist revolution was abolishing the unjust disbalance, not just between rich and poor, white and non-white, or man and woman, but between subject and object in principle. In aesthetical context, between artist and his model, for example, male artist and female model, and to abolish this problem by creation of abstract art in early avant-garde, or more artist and work as such, which was the next step. And this might have been abolished by creation of special kind of non-alienated artworks, which was the biggest challenge of communist aesthetics. This is actually what merging of art and life in practice means. The first step was to overlook art objects altogether. This is why the institutions of communist art were, as it is well known, built around artists and their communications, and rather than around consumption or even production of artworks. The normative institutional system we all are working now is built around collecting, producing artworks, selling them in galleries, collecting them by private collectors, private foundations, and museums. But it was not the case in Soviet Union, all the institutions were built around the very fact of artists coming together and actually discussing their work. And if they did produce any work or not, actually was not that important, even in early years of union of artists, that it is well demonstrated now by documents. And of course, the late years of Union of Artists, some of us might remember that it was not actually necessary to produce anything to be called artist. It was important to be a member of the community, which means participating from time to time in a different kind of discussions. It is true that subject-object relations are not innocent. They are rooted in the operation of exchange. One can add that communism was aiming at demolishing not just money exchange, but exchange as such, leaving only production, understood as creative production, as creation. Former objects, which mean women, oppressed classes, but real objects, real things as well, didn't take place in the market, didn't take part in the market anymore, and had to be re-educated to become unalienated friends and politically aware comrades. So this is a well-known cover by Stenberg Brothers, which were later used by Lisitsky and Senkin in this in the no less famous press photo montage for an exhibition in Cologne. The character of this montage is holding a newspaper as a machine which produces subjectivity, his own subjectivity. This newspaper tells him something he doesn't know of himself yet. And the subjectivity of the thing itself becomes his brother, so to speak, brother in arms. While Monastirsky in his finger is holding a device which produces an object out of him, objectifies him. He is performing an object, using this performative object. Returning to Stenberg and Soviet context, it is important to mention that even in the early avant-garde, they were using the term non-objective painting, беспредметное искусство, which doesn't actually, it's not exactly the same as abstraction. You know that Russian artists did not that much like the word, the term abstraction. They were preferring the беспредметное, the non-objective painting, which meant not just, and not always, by the way, that there were no objects inside the painting. As you know, Kandinsky did tolerate objects for at least in his Russian period, and his task as a painter was to teach a viewer to overlook these objects. This was not about not having any objects inside the painting. This was about the painting itself should not be an object itself. Search for a painting which would not be an object separate from its creator. And you know that one of the main ideas of Kandinsky was that artists should switch from performing someone else's ideas to what he was calling composition, creating to be a composer instead of musical performer, yeah, so to speak. But in fact, the performative moment was also kept by him because he was not speaking about delegating the task of creating a painting after your ideas. He was thinking of an artist as a composer performing his or her own works. And this moment of performance of the work was important and then developed during the Russian non-market avant-garde and especially Soviet avant-garde. What does it mean for an art object to be transferred to a register of subjectivities instead of objects? First, it's an egalitarian approach, a radically egalitarian approach, because this subjectivization meant artworks could not be judged by quality or beauty alone, like we do not judge our friends by this criterion alone. And how harsh Soviet critic might have been, they never based their criticism on this beauty or form moment alone. They were mostly speaking about content, about some ideas the work should project on the audience. So the notion of bourgeois quality was radically abolished. Second, it changed completely the perspectives and expectations of the quality and of longevity of artworks. If art and life merged, we have to accept mortality of art as we do it for ourselves. Works were not necessarily kept and could very often be destroyed. Propaganda installations, some kind of critical sculptures which did exist in late 20s, early 30s, and even paintings, in many types of artworks were actually destroyed, or at least they died of natural, out of natural reasons, I would say. Only a very, very small part of Soviet paintings were kept in museums, which was a kind of relict of pre-revolutionary bourgeois situation, lobbied by the artists themselves, but irrelevant for the idea of art on the scale of the whole country. Architects were like famous urban planner Mikhail Okitovich were speaking about cities disappearing, not just bourgeois cities, but proletarian cities as well, gradually disappearing, be covered by weeds, grass, and somehow dissolving into landscape. It is in this sense that Soviet art underwent radical dematerialization. Any object was considered just a temporary realization of a more important idea. And works were not unique. When art market for individual consumers was destroyed, a different kind of distribution was built. Works were distributed exclusively in reproductions. Of course, for contemporary exhibitions of Stalinist art, contemporary Western institutions do borrow originals from Tretiakov Gallery and Russian Museum, but it is actually against the main idea of Soviet art, where only reproductions were valid, because they were reaching much larger audiences. At some most radical point, paintings were considered just work pieces, half-finished products, and were not kept at all. Half-finished products like negatives, and artists were paid in a system of royalties. Under the conditions of non-market art making, artworks of any media reached its audience not as a unique autonomous object, but through a multifaceted system of reproductions, postcards, popular magazines, newspapers, identical public sculptures in every single city and village of the USSR. And these are real works of Soviet art, not the paintings by Alexander Dineko. An original artwork in contemporary understanding, under these conditions, appeared as a matrix, a Lubok, meant to be reproduced. Documentary newspaper photography, the predominant medium for Soviet avant-garde artists after 25, was indeed a model to which paintings and sculptures aligned themselves. So these two institutions, real institutions, two types of real institutions of Soviet art, actually marked two most important movements inside Moscow conceptualism. So when we take the first one, printed materials, magazines, posters, film, photography, museums where non-art museums, where document and reproductions were kept and exhibited. So this is the line of Moscow conceptualism, including, of course, those artists who worked as a book illustration, Kabakov, Bulatov, and younger generation like Vadim Zakharov and many others. So this is one line, but it includes also Andrei Monastirsky, who worked, as it, you might know, in a museum of literature, literary museum, which is part of this non-art museum of reproductions and documents, very developed in Soviet Union. And the second line is public art, where these Lenin sculptures, where production was usually delegated, also a very contemporary way of producing art. And this is the line where Soz art artists, including Comrade Melamed, Alexander Kosolapov, Leonid Sokov, and Dmitry Pribgov, and many others were involved. Except for rare visit to the Tretiakov Gallery in Moscow, which were extremely rare and never happened for those who lived not in Moscow, for example, it was considered that a place where an individual activity meets unique works of art was his own apartment, where he actually produces this art. The unique was seen as a part of the performative practice. Amateur photography was very much supported and promoted under the condition it would remain unique and not distributed. But of course, mostly the performative practice of music, theater, amateur belly dance was very much promoted in Soviet Union. And the practice of Moscow conceptualism was based on this non-professional art making in the performative mode. So they were performing artwork as a part of non-professional activity. But of course, more reflexive than the purely amateurish art, and testing grounds of alienation and reification, this necessary byproduct of exhibiting gesture as such. Yesterday, Boris Groys reminded us that a gesture of art making includes taking the risk of presenting it to the public. It is exactly this risk which Soviet artists, be it professional or amateur, were denied in their everyday practice. Amateur artists did only show their work to a circle of fellow kolkhozniks or friends, as in case of Moscow conceptualism, which is the same. But the shows of Union of Artists didn't imply any outsider audience at all. The shows were unpopular, and audience didn't have any chance to express the meanings or feelings or opinions in this work. So it would be a mistake to think that official art in Soviet Union was popular. Not at all. There's huge exhibitions were staying empty. The Soviet society was generally strangely safe about being exposed to the rest of society. Being a woman or an ethnic minority or a poor one or a fat one, an old one, an ugly one, one didn't risk being humiliated in comparison with contemporary capitalist world. Even to be Jewish had its advantages, believe me. Soviet citizen was constantly exposed to the gaze of the other, but this gaze was considered as rather benevolent as a whole and not comparing you to others. To become an official artist meant to take this kind of risk. And this is what exactly this practice of Moscow conceptualism is about, testing very cautiously, very gradually, these grounds of exposure of art objects. If we now look at contemporary art practice, especially very briefly, especially in the field of the so-called critical art, we will see that these conditions of Soviet art production and distributions are actually also exist nowadays. The notion of the quality is successfully abolished in contemporary critical art, whatever we would be told. So only content which is important. The non-refundable, so to speak, or eternal character of artwork is challenged and often destroyed. So what we see at the exhibitions, especially in terms of this critical art and non-market art, is something which will be destroyed after an exhibition and produced again, not to transport and not to pay for the transport in the next stop of an exhibition. It's more often than not the contemporary artwork, more often than not a unique thing. It's a video, it's a photograph, it's a print of different kind, it's an installation which is being rebuilt. Uniqueness and autonomy of an artwork is not encouraged by this system, although the system itself is very autonomous, and the autonomy of art is projected into the system of institutions themselves, but not onto the work in contemporary so-called progressive art. And this system of critical progressive art we are all part of now created a system of production, art projects, commissioned works, and distribution through magazines, including Flux magazine and the others, which is alternative to the classical market. And now is a very strong alternative, which we all rely on more than the market itself. And the market is being considered and used by critical artists punctually to support their research. So the artists, as well know, they're selling things from time to time, but it's being considered not their main economic, at least for many of them, not their main economic support, but as a partial support of their main research activity. Returning to Soviet conceptual practices of the 70s, just some of the examples of this experimentation of autonomous art production, this performing art objects as an experiment. Kabakov, to whom belongs this mug? When in his kitchen series, Kabakov keeps asking, who does this mug belong to? And this recurrent question often remains unanswered. His obscure protagonist is longing for private property. In Brezhnev's Soviet Union, where a person rarely had his own room, and in fact had very little to consider his own at all, one of these Kabakovian objects could be a fly, leaving the dream of ownership as ardent as it was unrealistic. The very fact that Kabakov was able to discern one fly from all the others signaled an experiment with the separate nature of a single work, or one isolated object of aesthetic contemplation within the plethora of communal items. Rediscovering objects, of course, they were rediscovering a position of an outsider. And testing the grounds of individual art making, Soviet unofficial artists were breaking an unspoken but dangerous taboo, creating a situation of potential display. Here is Boris Mikhailov, who in the 60s was an amateur photographer, and he was always asked to document the pristine and boring everyday life of the Sleepy Research Institute, where he was officially employed. His unidealized, non-heroic snapshots of plump, middle-aged women performing gymnastic exercises were most probably appearing in a wall newspaper on the Institute and well received by his superiors. Well, they were originally black and white. Just imagine this photograph as black and white one. Contrary to many Westerners, so to speak, this was not a satirical or critical image at all. This was quite a normal image which could be used in any local newspaper, so to speak. But as soon as Mikhailov started to set aside negatives, some of them, to isolate one snapshot from a series, to print it anew and to color it by hand, performing a most primitive gesture of painting in the most kitschy way, just to show that it was a unique thing instead of a printed photograph. As soon as he did it, as soon as he started to see himself as an artist producing unique works, he crossed the symbolic line towards individual production. Potentially, this hand-painted photograph represented a treat. They could have been exhibited, maybe even abroad, without the knowledge of those in the photo. They could have been used to fulfill artists' own goals, artistic or even political. By creating an obvious artwork, Mikhailov was stepping out of the collective. He was betraying collective for art. No surprise, he was finally fired and started his independent artistic career, which took place already in the West. Why? No, it's simply too big. This is another Monastirsky, I breathe, I hear. Another device of alienation and performance of an artwork where he produced a machine, a device, so to speak, which was allowing him to listen to the sound of his own breath. Another experimental artwork of this kind is Heap, where people who were coming to Monastirsky's apartment were asked to donate their own small items and to create a heap of them, which gradually became an artwork. At the end of the day, there were 80 or even 100 of them. And this work actually is nothing else than performing a transfer of ownership, where the switch, what is at stake here is the switch from non-alienated to alienated objects, which finally represent an artwork. Earthworks by from 87, or Excavations, is it also translated, Zemliny Raboty by Andrei Monastirsky. A whole project which includes a text, a later installation, and photo series, which can be, I think, seen in its own right and be compared to earlier, but close in the intention, Robert Smithson's snapshots of Passaic in New Jersey or Andrew Shea's 26 gasoline stations of late 60s. Nondescript sites with no artistic pedigree, plain bed photos, but within a different socio-cultural context. Here, Monastirsky is making a stroll through this nondescript site of sites of Moscow, and what he sees are objects between art, architecture, and life. These products of the illegal link between art and life, these bastards of these insane relationships, including, so Mikhail Okhitovich, whom I mentioned today, was projecting and was even building kiosks built with recycled biological materials, which of course didn't survive, and in the 70s they were still staying, but people don't even have photographs of them, even if he was a major figure of Soviet architecture and urban planning. Nobody even had an idea of making a photograph of this kiosk because they didn't look as art objects at all, as many of the objects, these art life objects of Soviet production. So Monastirsky doesn't see them, but he makes photos of other kiosks, other objects. Which have no obvious purpose and look as art objects for them. And in a scheme he draws for this project, he draws a scheme where the so-called social reality, which he ascribes to the state, appears under the term expositional sign field, expозиционное знаковое поле, ideological and full of meanings, while art and art of his friends exist inside in a demonstrational sign field, демонстрационное знаковое поле. So the art of collective actions in Monastirsky exists already in the landscape where everything is totally exposed, but not demonstrated. So this gesture of risky demonstration, taking the responsibility of an artwork, is something which is being added to this landscape by Monastirsky himself and his group. The artist who's taking a liberty to perform an artwork inside the already deconstructed landscape of art life. In his text, Monastirsky actually writes about this art life production of Soviet authorities and city authorities as something which was very important for his own practice. He calls it an inspirator. This inspirator served an important point for his own practice because ideological changement in Soviet context were going through material ones, excavations, earthworks. In this photograph, Monastirsky, we see Monastirsky himself, who points at a place where one of these most important inspirators actually was located. So it is at the moment where he's pointing at it, it doesn't exist anymore. This was a huge hole in the ground, which, as Monastirsky writes, was an important thing he was referring his whole activity to. During 2 or 3 years, Moscow authorities were digging deep into the ground, and nobody did actually understand what for. At some point, Monastirsky could see that it was a very deep hole, so it was not something connected with the subway, and nobody actually understood what it is. It was a purely aesthetical installation, we could say, without this liberty of having demonstrated it to the public. And this is Monastirsky who takes this liberty as an artist. A device he's pointing at this non-site of a non-existing non-art object is actually his own work. It's an object which is called soft handle. And so here's the what he could see where he saw this when it was open, the ground was open. So the soft handle is the object which was used in several performances of collective actions, during which Monastirsky, in several situations, as he writes, was looking at some of the events he manipulated or he invented or he made people perform, looking at it being one about the only spectator of this situation, he was obsessively winding this white cord around the handle of this strange object, flat one. It's a reproduction of the clock here. It's not a real clock. producing a performance almost invisible and certainly not having any sense to the audience, even if they could see this kind of strange gesture. But the object itself was changing. So the most important point for Monastirsky here, that the object was continued to live. He was it was changing during the performance in the most unnoticeable way. So this notion of unnoticed, unnoticeable artwork, blending with the whole landscape of the action, not speaking of the landscape of reality, it was something which collective actions and Monastirsky actually borrowed from this Soviet art life dissolution, this practice. Now to conclude. It is usually considered that the classical conceptual art is still built, like classical avant-garde, around the paradigm of the end of art. We rarely speak about it since the 80s, if I'm not wrong. The language of death of art doesn't work on us anymore. Burning, cutting, minimalizations of different kind, Greenbergian self-criticism of the media reduced to its minimum. Everything disappeared, at least in the discursive field, with the digital revolution Boris Groys was talking about yesterday. Artists would rather identify with Greenberg's definition of kitsch, I would say, especially because he puts as his first criteria of kitsch that it's a reproduction. And we shouldn't forget that he was actually influenced very much. He was a Trotskyist, he knew about Soviet practice, and he was actually influenced by this post-Trotskyist neo-Stalinist, as he thought, practice of cultural revolution, which included lots of reproduction and the shift of art from unique production to the reproductions. An artist today is identifying rather with kitsch, and this kitsch in Greenbergian sense can even be more easily critical in comparison to self-critical avant-garde, at least in a journalistic sense. And Greenberg, in his famous text, mentions New Yorker as one kind of intellectual kitsch. At least kitsch can be critical in a journalistic sense, but it is exactly in this sense and that we usually expect art to be critical today. But we still expect artists to be aware of the death of art, to master this language as a part of high professionalism, as opposed to kitsch. And art education is still somehow based on this language of death of art as something we should master and understand as some people who are part of a community of the post-avant-garde. Death of art expressed in art is perfection rather than transgression. But this was not the case Soviet conceptual artists, not the situation Soviet conceptual artists were living in, surrounded by huge amounts of folk conceptual art, of amateurish art production not aimed to be neither beautiful nor perfect in forms, but more like expressing their own conceptual ideas in this folk conceptual production. And the next step Monastirsky was taking with collective action was to reflect on this type of the folk production, which is, of course, has its parallels with the situation Boris Groys was describing yesterday with YouTube, Twitter, and all the other kinds of amateurish art production today. What then, if we would rather deal not with death of art, the discourse of death of art, but the discourse with emergence of something that we might even call art, inside the already burned landscape of unfinished semi-artworks and unrealized artistic individualities, which was the reality of Soviet Union and might be the reality of our future. At least this turn will bring different discourses into the field of amateurism rather than professionalism, imperfection rather than irreproachability, education rather than demonstration, embarrassment rather than pleasure. When we're speaking about classical conceptual works and analyzing them, as well as works of early avant-garde like Black Square and other abstract works. What works in our perception is usually the mechanism of regret. We see something and we are supposed to feel the regret of something we have lost, as the first viewer of the Black Square had to regret that he lost the images of pink nudes forever, so to speak. We still are supposed to feel this two-way, to have this two-way perception of the work and to feel the loss of something we did not get. Here, in a different perspective I'm talking about now, we see not what is and what has been or might have been, but what is in front of us and what might come in the future. That's how we look at amateurish work. We usually don't. Yeah? We professionals, we usually don't look at amateurish or bad works, but I would actually recommend it because it's a very interesting aesthetic experience which gives us a possibility to split our perception into two completely different fields. One is something which is in front of us. Another thing which this artist might become when he will learn such and such things, but we might then regret that he did. But we see this discrepancy between two worlds, something which is given and something which is yet to come, and which is also actually described by Marx in some of his texts. This is a perspective which is, I would say, very gives us an unexplored possibilities which we still are waiting, you know, to come. I guess Moscow, this is something Moscow conceptualism might tell us to do. There is actually, as a very last point, there is already an artwork which goes in this direction, an art form which goes in this direction, which is called project. What actually project means? Project means what we see is not yet finished, like this hole in the ground and strange architectural and semi-artistic forms which Monastirsky discovered close to his own apartment, is something yet to come. It's a project which is open to the future, where we tolerate that it is not satisfactory yet, waiting for something which might or might not come. So this is a perspective, I think, Moscow conceptualism teaches us to take, which might be useful for our own next future. Thank you.